imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes, when I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or when all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? I'll be able to speak it all. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or will all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees? I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
Good morning and welcome as we gather for worship here at Trinity United Church of Christ that is located in Brookfield on Calhoun Road. And as we continue to remain at home and in our varied neighborhoods, we are still the people gathered in Christ's name. It's getting to be a long time since we've really gotten to see each other and be in the sanctuary. And I'm aware that that wears on us, and we'd love to be back in, but the wisdom of not only kind of the science, but the wisdom of what's happening in many churches that tried to reopen is that it's not been always successful. So We choose to err on the side of just waiting, and this waiting is hard, and I know it. So my love and support and prayers to all of you in this time as we come together in Christ's name. We have a saying in the United Church of Christ, which is, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And today that statement really fits, because as we walk with Jesus, as we go through the stories of faith with him, we begin to see that that's exactly how he met people. Wherever they were on their journey, that's where he met them. He didn't judge them. He didn't condemn them. He met them, and then he treated them with grace. And often that grace released a new life in them. So we're continuing to walk that path and to understand what this grace is all about. So I bring you grace and peace from God our Creator and from our Master and Teacher, Jesus Christ, and from the Holy Spirit, who binds us together in unity and in love. Let us worship. Amen.
Please join me in this morning's call to worship. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all the people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. From his fullness, we have all received grace upon grace.
Spoken Zion City of our God, he whose word cannot be broken, formed thee for his own abode. On the rock of ages founded, what can shake thy sure repose? With salvation's walls surround, such a river ever.
Please join me in this morning's prayer. We know the violence of our lives. This month, we remember victims of domestic abuse, the violence often done to those of differing sexual orientation, the violence against those with mental health issues, and the violence done to the indigenous people who live among this land. Teach us the ways of grace as we follow Jesus, that we may meet violence and difference with mercy and grace. Amen. Today's epistle lesson is from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destines us for adoption as his children through Christ Jesus, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he has freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth.
Good morning, children and youth. Good to be with you again this morning, and I'm holding you in my prayers as well through all these times of transition and change in our lives. May God's peace settle upon you as well. This morning, we're talking about a word called grace. And grace is a word that the scriptures use, especially the New Testament. And they come to us from both John, but then later from an apostle named Paul. And today's story is about Paul. And you're going to hear it read in scripture. And it will be a story about Paul getting himself in trouble as he's going out to preach the gospel. And he's kind of released a young girl from a spirit that had held her, and her masters had used that to make money off of her. So she is now free and released, and the owners are mad. So they get Paul and his disciples thrown into the jail. And while they're in the jail, they're at midnight singing and praying, and all of a sudden there's this great earthquake. And this great earthquake trembles the whole area and breaks open the doors and breaks down the walls of the jail. And there's just mass confusion everywhere. So all of a sudden, the jailer realizes that this was a perfect way for Paul and his disciples to break out of prison. And so he's about ready to take his own life, to cut his neck, it says, because he knew that if he'd let any of these people out, his life was no good anyway. That's what he'd been told, that if he let somebody out, he was as good as dead. So he took it into his own hands. And as he did, Paul called out and said, "Don't hurt yourself. Don't kill yourself. We're still here." And so what that experience was for this jailer, who thought people would use this against him, is that he discovered how gracious Jesus' disciples really were. They would stay and put their own life at the service of this jailer. And the jailer was so overwhelmed by their graciousness and their gift of grace to him that he immediately wanted to become a follower of Jesus. And he immediately wanted to get his family baptized. And so all of that happened because this gracious and this grace that Paul was able to extend to the neighbor, to the jailer, was a part of his life. And it's kind of an amazing thing for us to even imagine giving a gift like that to someone else. But this is what we are called to in Christ's name. Let's pray. Holy God, we thank you for this gift of grace that we have seen in Jesus Christ. Help us to become those who bear grace to one another, even if it sometimes means we will be hurt or we will have to make tough decisions. Bless our work as your people, O God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great day.
A reading from the early church, Acts chapter 16, verses 24 through 34. Following these instructions, he put them in the inmost cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was an earthquake so violent that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer woke up and saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, since he supposed that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted out in a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." The jailer called for lights, and rushing in, he fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them outside and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They answered, "Believe on the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." They spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. At the same hour of the night, he took them and washed their wounds. Then he and his whole family was baptized without delay. He brought them up into the house and set food before them. And he and his entire household rejoiced that he had become a believer in God.
Over the years, as I've been preaching, I begin to, after all this time, sort of cull things down into two central words that really, for me, define both the life of Christ and our response to that life. And those two words are faith and grace. I almost forgot them. faith and grace. And so today I want to talk a little bit about grace. We heard it read in John, and then we heard it also read in the church, the letter to the church at Ephesus, in which Paul writes, "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not of your own doing. It is a gift of God, given to all so that none of you may boast." God wants us to understand that all of us are equal before God. There are none of us that are better because of the works we do. There are none of us that deserve or merit God's love and mercy. It is all a gift of grace to us. We all fall short, and we are all lifted up by grace. So today I want to talk a little bit about grace in light of all the violence that is going on around us. This month we remember domestic violence and domestic abuse victims. We remember people like Matthew Shepard, a gay man who was killed 22 years ago for his sexual orientation. We remember Indigenous Peoples Day and the stories that I've heard in person of the brutality that tried to strip away humanity from the Native cultures here in America. We have tasted and seen, and we know, of course, the brutality towards the blacks that continues out of this ancient idea of slavery. We know this violence, and we know it deep in our spirit. It seems that one of the most common ways that we have of dealing with people who are different than us, people who don't agree with us, people who won't do the things that we think they should do, is this idea of violence. Violence runs through our veins. Even in the Old Testament, we hear these stories in which the people felt that God was calling them to take a land by violence and force, even though that land was already inhabited, and then proclaimed the blessings of God upon that. But we might begin to question that a little in our lives when we begin to examine the stories of Jesus. You see, this baser self, what the scriptures, particularly Paul, talks about as the old self or the old nature, is a common hardwired element in all of our lives. We respond to various things in our life through kind of old-fashioned kind of base instincts, like flight or fight. And one of our responses to dealing with people who are different than us or disagree with us is this idea of violence. All over, we see tribes and clans of people gathering with like, anxious to keep out the other. We are hardwired to feed our ego, to get what we want when we want it. All of us share these common traits. But then something most strange occurs on a Friday in Jerusalem. Paul, a Jew himself, would look back on it for the rest of his life. God's own representative, God's beloved child, would take another tact that would forever change the world. We know that Jesus endured some of the most violent treatment a prisoner of that time could receive. He was taken under cover of night and interrogated. He was falsely accused. There was no one to defend his rights or his honor. He was tortured. He was beaten. He was stripped. He was lashed. He had to carry his own cross while wearing a crown of thorns. He was humiliated. And finally, he was murdered upon a cross. It was a long and violent death. There was nothing easy about it. He was even denied food or water during those long hours. He was mocked. He was called names. And his loved ones had to stand by, and all they could do was watch and wait. This was how God's own child died. There were moments where his disciples were ready to fight for him, to engage with their own violence against the soldiers. But Jesus told them to put down their weapons. Jesus met violence with grace in that day. Jesus did not continue to practice the patterns of violence. He shattered it with grace. He prayed for those who killed him. "Father, they don't know what they are doing." I've been taking this in now for a good week. This one act reforms how those who follow Christ are called to respond to others. This one act calls us to think about how we respond to violence, not by adding more violence, but by practicing grace. The most interesting thing about this act of grace in the face of violence is that it continues with others who follow Jesus. Paul, when he was imprisoned and beaten, responds to the jailer with grace, recognizing him not as the enemy, but as one who, like him, is in need of God's grace. Throughout the generations, thousands upon thousands of people have laid down their lives rather than demanding justice or revenge, and by their actions of grace, they have paved a new highway in the wilderness. There is a different story, not only to be told, but to live. Thanks be to God for the witnesses who have lived their lives by grace through faith. "While we were yet sinners," write Paul, "Christ died for us." When we were in outright rebellion against God, when we treated people without compassion or mercy, Christ went to the cross for us. There is a wonderful movie called Pay It Forward. That's the kind of gift this is. God doesn't ask us to fawn all over God or say, "Oh, how great you are for saving us." God says, "Pay it forward. Send it on with someone else. Share it with one another." This is a great equalizer. None of us stands above another. The law of the judges is shattered and we are set free. We are no longer condemned. We are forgiven and saved and healed and delivered from our violent past. We are a new creation in Christ. So this is the gift that we are called to pay forward. We are to meet people where they are, not as we would have them to be, but to welcome them, to get them to know them just where they are, rather than to demand that they fit in with us. You see, there's a lot of violence that isn't physical that goes on. And every day we participate in it with our harsh words of condemnation or gossip or anger or hate. Each day we have a choice as those who have received grace. How will we treat those who aren't like us? How will we treat those who are antagonistic towards us with violence or with grace upon grace. Amen. As we come to our time of joys and concerns, as always, I invite you to lift up those who you have a special call to pray for. And I want you to know that today all of you are held in my prayers. I know that many of you have been experiencing some very challenging and difficult times. I know that many of you are still grieving losses of those dear to you. I know many of you are struggling with issues of mental health. I know that many of you are just struggling to get through the days, and I want you to know that you're not forgotten, that even though we don't see each other face to face, you are still very near in my heart, and you are often on my thoughts during these days. Especially, we lift up Bev Littman, who suffered a small mini stroke. We give thanks that it was only a small stroke, but it has changed some of the dynamics of her life. So that information will be in the MailChimp and coming out with a new address and a way to reach her, particularly through her son. And we lift up Bev and her family in these days. I also want us to just take some time to lift up those places where there is still so much violence. We live in a time where there is just violence so many places that you see. And so we lift up today those who are struggling in relationships where there is domestic abuse and where people are trying to find a way to be set free from that ongoing kind of agony and abuse. And we remember those who have been bullied for disabilities or for sexual orientation. And we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our African American communities where violence, even after all of these years, is still heavily perpetrated upon them and in our Native American cultures and communities as well. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And I pray that God will heal us, that we will begin to extend grace upon grace in situations where we could surely extend hostility or anger or words of blame, and that we would find ways to be gracious to one another in these days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now let us pray the prayer that Jesus gave his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, lots of things continue to go on in our life and ministry, and so we continue to see a lot of ongoing activity as we prepare for the month of November with some special services, and the Worship and Arts team has been working on that to get invitations out, both for our All Saints Remembrance Day and for our Veterans Day Remembrance. So be looking for those pieces of information, and those will be special days coming to us in November. Today, you have an opportunity on Sunday afternoon to go out and help one of our Boy Scouts do raise food and money for the Humane Society and for taking care of animals. So that will be happening in the parking lot as well. And if you can head over there and drop something off, that would be so very much appreciated. The clothing drive continues, and the mission team is more than happy to either come and pick things up, or if you put it in a box or a bag and put it by the church, the front of the church, or if there's somebody in the office, then just leave it there. So please feel free to do that. If you have any questions, please call Dave Melke. He'll give you the straight scoop on what's going on. We also had some sad news, I guess, for us, but good news for Kathy Schein. Kathy was able to find a job that she had been hoping to get before she got ours. And so she has given her notice of 2 weeks of resignation, and she will be leaving us October 23rd. If you'd like to call Kathy, if you'd like to drop her a note, please do so. She has made such a difference in our life together. She has shared with us tremendous gifts and brought so much joy to us with her, especially with her art and her graphic gifts. So we will miss her. We send her on with our love and our prayers, and are delighted that she has an opportunity to use her gifts in a new space. The business and office team is aware of this and will be looking for people to be in the office during the time, and then be in the search process for someone new to be in our office. So if you know of a friend or family member who might be interested in interviewing, please get a hold of Kathy Imicus or someone from the business and office team, or Terry Allen, and they will be able to direct you to how to get that name put forward. All right, so I think that's all for our life and ministry. As you can see, things are never dull around Trinity, and even when we're scattered and apart, we're still really making a difference in the world. So have a great week. Talk to you soon. We have been blessed so that we can become a blessing. Of those who have received much, much is required, says the scriptures, and we know that we are a people who have received so very much. And so I continue to urge you to be generous, to be a grateful people in this time, to do what you can to make a difference, to help out in the church where you can, to offer your gifts not only to us, but to others as well. Thank you for the generosity that you've shown to the church. We cherish the gifts that you continue to send so that we can continue this ministry, even though it's in a very different form. And we are able now to do a Zoom ministry with children and youth about their Sunday school work. And so we're grateful for that and for the people that have been handling that in just so many ways. So thank you, and let us share together in the prayer of dedication. We thank you, O Holy One, for your guidance and protection during these days. We give thanks for the gifts you have planted within us and commit ourselves to use our gifts to make a difference, to bring abundant life and love in the world you so love. Let our offering be a blessing to others. Amen.
My feet, my while I run this race. Guide my feet,
oh, yes, my
while I run this race. Guide my feet,
oh, yes, my
while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in vain. Hold my hand
while I run this race.
Child,
yes, my while I run this race.
I'm your child,
yes, my
while I run this race. I'm your child.
Yes, my God, I run this race, for I don't want to run this race in vain.
Stand by me.
Oh, yes, my God,
while I run this race. Stand by me.
Oh, yes, my God,
while I run this race. Stand by me.
Oh, yes, my God,
while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in vain. Wheel with me.
Yes,
while I run this race. Wheel with me.
Oh, yes,
while I run this race. Wheel with me.
Oh, yes,
while I run this race. For I don't want to run this race in vain. For I don't want to run this race in vain. For I don't want to run this race in vain.
And now a blessing for the road. We have received grace upon grace. Each day our lives are filled with evidence of God's gifts to us that bring us joy and hope and love. Go forth and become a gracious people, meeting people wherever they are, and beginning to know them and offering them grace in Jesus' name. Go in peace, love, and serve the Lord. Amen.
Turn, turn, turn.